I'm looking for a bird that's sitting on the nest, but it can be tricky in areas especially that are really rocky like this because the birds are so good at blending in with their surroundings.
The study began in 2013 to track the movements of birds in coastal and offshore areas because very little is known about how they're using flight paths to travel throughout our region. And it's particularly relevant in regards to offshore wind energy development. So that's a development of offshore wind turbines. So the information is going to help managers make decisions about siting and monitoring offshore wind energy areas. In 2013, we tagged terns on Monomoy National Wildlife Refuge on Cape Cod, and we also tagged oyster catchers on Cape Cod and Nantucket. We had another really successful year in 2014, collected a lot of data, and we were able to expand the study now in 2015 to include piping plovers and roseate terns, two federally listed species which are of the highest conservation concern.
There's a lot of factors contributing to their population decline. Plovers nest on sandy beaches in the open, and they're not particularly defensive. They rely on cryptic coloration and behavior to sort of camouflage their nests. They have a lot of problems with dogs, coyotes, anything that has a good nose that can sniff out the nest. There's also avian predators, crows, gulls. There's a lot of good work happening with trying to reverse the population declines, but it's tough.
So now we're gonna walk this way and wait for the bird to return.
The study is funded by the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management. It's administered by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service Division of Migratory Birds.
All right, it's going back.
And it's in partnership with UMass Amherst, overseeing the research and the field components.
Beautiful.
So it's really neat to work with such a big collaboration of people.
YC6, yep.
Peter Payton has done a lot of work with offshore wind energy planning in Rhode Island.
117.
117 for the wing.
He's done a lot of work with snowy plovers, a similar species to the piping plover, and with terns, so he's a great person to have on board. Cal is a UMass alum. He did environmental sciences and has been working in the field ever since. And then we work very closely with the Rhode Island National Wildlife Refuge staff who are out on the beach every day. And there's several other people who have been really helpful. They really have their finger on the pulse of what's going on with piping plovers in Rhode Island.
So this is what we're going to attach to the back of the bird. It's a VHF transmitter. It's called a nano tag.
All right. So we're trying to make a pocket so it's surrounded off on all sides by feathers and then contacting the skin. That's awesome. That looks great.
Yeah, that's
all right,
good.
Cal, we're ready. So place it right in. Perfect. So it sits right on their back, kind of over their center of gravity, and then the antenna trails behind. This transmitter weighs 1 gram. It has a battery life of about 4 months. And thousands of these transmitters can be uniquely identified on a single VHF frequency.
We want the tags to fall off, but not before they leave for migration.
They seem to get used to it pretty quick. We will observe them preening the antenna when they're preening their feathers, but usually they resume normal behavior shortly after we release them.
Nobody has specifically tracked these species this way around the clock and during all types of weather conditions. So we designed this new type of radio telemetry tower. It's 40 feet tall and it has 6 high range antennas. We set up these towers from Cape Cod all the way down to Eastern Long Island. The antennas feed into this receiving unit. Now it's scanning the antenna pointing 60 degrees, so that's northeast. Oh, now it just picked up ID 344. We track their movements pretty much continuously from when we attach the tags during the breeding period to the post-breeding period when they move around quite a bit more throughout the study area, and then as they depart on migration. I'm currently analyzing the data from 2013 and 2014. So I'm sort of trying to analyze data and do the field work at the same time, which is a little crazy, but it's a lot of fun. And I'm hoping to finish summer of 2016. So I think total I have like 8 million data points for my dissertation, which is a little bit overwhelming, but it's all good stuff.